Welcome to The Explainer. Today we're diving into a question that sounds like it's straight out of science fiction, but it's being taken very seriously by philosophers and scientists. What if consciousness isn't just in our heads? What if the entire universe is conscious? This is the wild, mind-bending idea behind a theory called panpsychism.
But first, I want you to think about something that seems almost ridiculously simple, but it's one of the deepest mysteries we know of. Just forget what you're thinking or feeling for a second. The real question is, why do you have an inner world, a subjective experience, in the first place? There's this huge, unexplained gap between the physical, biological brain sitting in your skull and the actual feeling of being you.
And this gap, it's not just some quirky thought experiment for philosophers. It's a real, specific problem that has completely stumped scientists for centuries. It's so tough, in fact, that it's forcing some of the smartest people around to take a serious look at some pretty radical ideas.
It's famously called the hard problem of consciousness. See, science is absolutely brilliant at solving what we might call the easy problems. You know, tracking how the brain crunches data or sends signals to control your body. But it just hits a total brick wall when it tries to explain why all of that information processing feels like anything from the inside. Why is there that raw feeling of seeing the color red or tasting salt? Philosophers have a word for these raw feelings, qualia, and explaining how they arise from inert matter is the hard problem.
Now, for a very long time, there have been two main theories that have tried to tackle this. But as you're about to see, both of them run into their own brick walls.
So the default view in science is what's called materialism. The idea is that consciousness just kind of emerges once you get matter that's complicated enough, like in a brain. But that's not really an explanation, is it? It's basically just saying, and then a miracle happens. On the other side, you have dualism. This is the more traditional idea, that your mind, or your soul, is a separate, non-physical thing. But that has its own killer problem. How exactly does a ghost drive the physical machine of the body? How do they interact?
And it's this stalemate, this gridlock, where neither of the main theories really works, that has led a lot of thinkers to go back and dust off a very, very old, and let's be honest, at first glance, a very strange third option.
And here it is, panpsychism. The core idea is that consciousness doesn't just suddenly pop into existence out of non-conscious stuff. Instead, it's a fundamental feature of matter itself. It's been there in some incredibly simple, basic form since the very beginning of the universe.
Okay, it is crucial to get clear on what this theory isn't saying. This is not about electrons having anxiety attacks or rocks sitting around pondering philosophy. No, panpsychism argues that fundamental particles, like an electron, have an unbelievably simple, primitive form of experience. Think of it as a kind of proto-consciousness, a basic building block of reality itself.
And just so you know, this isn't some new age fad that just popped up. Panpsychism has a really serious intellectual history. It seems to pop back up whenever the other theories about the mind hit a dead end. You can trace it all the way back to the ancient Greeks, then through Enlightenment thinkers like Spinoza, who were pushing back against that hard mind-body split. And now it's being revived today by modern philosophers who are bumping up against the limits of pure materialism.
So why on earth are so many smart, serious people giving this idea another look? Well, the modern argument for panpsychism isn't based on some kind of spiritual feeling or intuition. It's actually based on a really careful look at what science can tell us and, more importantly, what it can't. Okay, the main argument for panpsychism starts with a really strange fact about physics. Physics is incredible at describing what matter does. You know, its mass, its charge, its spin. But it is completely silent on what matter is in and of itself, its intrinsic nature. It gives us this perfect mathematical skeleton of the universe, but there's nothing filling it in. So the incredibly bold hypothesis of panpsychism is this. What if that missing ingredient, the inner essence of matter, is just consciousness itself?
The second big argument is all about continuity. It just seems really weird, almost like magic, to believe that you start with completely non-conscious bits of matter, atoms, molecules, and then bam, at some random level of complexity, like a brain, a light of consciousness just switches on out of nowhere. A much more elegant and, frankly, scientifically consistent view is that consciousness isn't an on-off switch. It's more like a dimmer switch that can fade up and down in complexity, but it never ever goes completely dark.
But here's the catch, and it's a big one. In trying to solve the hard problem of how consciousness even begins, panpsychism creates an equally difficult, brand new puzzle for itself.
So, if panpsychism is right, you have to picture a universe that is just filled with these countless little sparks of rudimentary experience. Trillions and trillions of tiny proto-minds at the level of quarks and electrons. This leads us right to the theory's single biggest challenge. It's called the combination problem. I mean, think about it. How could trillions of tiny, separate little points of experience, the microconsciousness of a quark, the microconsciousness of an electron, somehow bundle together to create your single, rich, unified mind? It's really not obvious how you can get one big, conscious subject by just smashing a bunch of little ones together.
And this isn't just one problem, it's more like a whole family of related problems. You've got the subject problem. How do all of those little subjects become one big subject instead of just a noisy crowd of subjects? Then you've got the quality problem. How do the super simple experiences of particles combine to create something as rich and complex as the smell of coffee? And there's the palate problem. How does the huge range of human emotions and thoughts come from what must be a very limited palette of experiences down at the particle level? For critics, this is the deal breaker. They say panpsychism doesn't solve the mystery, it just moves it around.
So, with this massive challenge on the table, where does that leave us? Let's take a step back and see how panpsychism stacks up against the other options, and maybe think about what it would actually mean for us if it turned out to be true. When you look at the whole philosophical landscape like this, you start to see something really fascinating. Every major theory of consciousness makes you take a big, hard-to-swallow pill. Materialism can't solve the hard problem. Dualism can't solve the interaction problem, and panpsychism, as we just saw, gets stuck with the combination problem. There's even a fourth, super extreme view called illusionism, which tries to solve the problem by just saying that your subjective experience isn't even real. So really, each view solves one puzzle, but only by creating another one.
But if panpsychism is true, the implications would be absolutely enormous. For starters, it would totally transform our ethics. If consciousness isn't just for humans and animals, but extends to things like plants and maybe even entire ecosystems, then all of a sudden, these things have their own intrinsic value. They matter for their own sake, not just for what they can do for us.
And that leads to some seriously tricky ethical knots. As the philosopher Philip Goff points out, if even plants have some very simple form of experience, then the clean moral line that a vegetarian might draw is suddenly gone. It forces us to radically rethink our place in the entire web of life.
But maybe the most profound shift would be an existential one. I mean, in a purely materialist world, it's easy to feel like we're just a cosmic accident, a brief, lonely flicker of awareness in a vast, dead, and ultimately meaningless universe. Panpsychism offers a completely different story. In this story, we're not an accident. We are a direct expression of a fundamental feature of the cosmos. We become participants in a universe that is, through us and all other life, slowly waking up to itself.
So, in the end, we're left with a choice between two staggering, almost unbelievable pictures of reality. Are we a conscious accident that popped up in an otherwise dead cosmos? Or are we the universe itself, slowly becoming aware? The answer to that question doesn't just define the world, it defines who and what we are.